We've done a number of tests, but the test I was responsible for was the physiology test. And the way that worked was we got John onto the treadmill for 10 minutes. He was hooked up to a range of machines. So we measured oxygen consumption, his heart rate, temperature.
We've been in the heat chamber this afternoon with the old and new kits on and really making a comparison to how quickly the new kit allows us to cool down as an elite athlete.
Wearing the old kit, he definitely feels hotter. His heart rate was so much higher. He actually lost more weight, so he sweated more. Now, that was just on a 10-minute simple test. If you extrapolate that over 18 minutes of a rugby game, those small little increments are going to lead to a massive performance difference.
One of the key things about rugby league is physical, it's fast. And it's powerful, and those things can all be greatly aided by sports science.
There's so many differences between a player 15 years ago and a player today. Science has really come into it now, and these guys, they're a lot fitter, they're a lot faster. When you combine that with these kind of technological improvements, these guys are different animals.
I think there's a very noticeable difference between the modern kit that we use and the kit that was used maybe 10 or 15 years ago. The modern kits are designed specifically for a purpose, and that's to perform at an elite level. For me, if you feel good in a kit and look good, I think that's much part of the battle is actually physically preparing for a game.
Yeah. train two or three times as hard, three times a day training. And I know physically we were in probably the best shape of our lives going to the World Cup. So you know, being here again is certainly going to put us back in that position going into the Six Nations.
First, there's been a biomechanical assessment of the player as he's kicked the ball through the kicking action of a field goal.
3, 2, 1, go.
Started out this morning looking at the new ball, my boots that I actually wear during a match, and the modern England change strip.
The first test was a new ball and new boots with a new kicking tee. The second test is an old boot and old ball off sand.
3, 2, 1, go. Go. Go.
We've seen that the new ball and new tee and new boots produce longer kicks and a longer range with the flight of the ball and more accuracy with the direction of the kick. We found that these small improvements have made a big difference in the performance of the athlete.
From the outside, it's a jumble of red laser light, 3D video images, computers, and oh yes, a rugby ball and a hooker. The idea is to work out what hookers need to do to get closer to that elusive goal.
Just making sure every throw is exactly the same.
How close are you getting to that point?
Oh, I'm a long way off, mate.
Researchers here hope to make it easier for hookers to learn how to be accurate.
We're giving an open mind, we want to pull out information like maybe head position is really important during the throw, whether they should step or not step, how wide their elbow should be, if they should keep their trunk upright or lean forward. So just really basic variables like that.
Emphasis here is different.
We're interested in how the body parts move. So we're interested more in the kinematics and the kinetics of it rather than the visual aspects of it. Yeah.
In addition, there are laser sensors to track the speed and angle of the ball and a 3D screen for hookers to aim at.
We're trying to merge some of the animation technology, and it has been used a lot in sport in the past as well. We want to take the benefits of animation and bring them into sports.
And although it's all new, Otago coaches are keen to try it out.
What Hayden's doing is tremendous for Otago and for the players, but also could become one of New Zealand's technology things as well.
All it needs now to simulate playing anywhere you thought you found a friend to take you out of this place, someone you could lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful day.
The study will gather data from more than 100 games throughout the season. One of the eight sides taking advantage of the concept is Harlequins.
So the GPS real-time system itself is basically made up of two parts. We have the satellite and the laptop. Quite simply, what we're seeing happen now is basically, as the session is actually happening, we're picking up all the data from the players. So the starting 15 for this weekend, we're picking up on data such as distance, heart rate, speeds at which they're running. For matches, it's exactly the same setup. Okay, the guys wear the units exactly as they are today. And again, we have that real-time feedback, so as the game's progressing and as the game's going on, the coaches come over and have a look and see where the guys are, basically what sort of state they're in. And basically up from that baseline data, we can basically cross-reference it and actually work out what sort of stress the guys are currently under during the game.
benefits for us this season is learning to, understanding the type of running volume they go through on a training day, the type of speeds they get to, their physical reaction to those stimulus, and how we can manipulate each training session to get the desired effect on a Saturday. We can see from a match data how far and how fast a player runs at, so we can determine match intensity. So we know at any stage during training if it's match intensity. So if we want to create a game intensity in certain scenarios at training, we can do that because we have the match data.
As fitness levels and the pace of the game increase, player welfare is also part of the study. The project is aiming to find out how GPS can be utilised as an aid to reduce injuries in the future.
The three injuries that keep players out of training and playing more than any other are shoulder dislocations, knee ligament damage, and hamstring strains. So for example, if a player has been running, repeat sprinting, and we can measure exactly how much running he's been doing, and then a hamstring tear occurs, and if we start to see that's a common pattern throughout all the players in the Premiership, we can start to do things to avoid those injuries happening. And that will be a huge step forward in terms of player welfare and keeping our best players fit to play more games.